ready to go. Ready to go. And good morning once again, everyone. Welcome back. I'm Chad Holmes, Chad Holmes Show on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, online at bowfallsradio.com, mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO, and on the Civic Media app. Currently some light rain out there. Temperature stands at 48 degrees at our downtown studios on the corner of Washington Street and North 3rd Street in downtown Wausau. First of all, apologize early in the first hour. We had some issues with our sound quality. We had to do a little repair work. And thanks to the folks down in Madison, we were able to get that all cleared away. And again, apologize that during the first half hour of the program that we had some issues with our sound. So again, apologize for that, and hopefully that will not happen again. But with technology, every once in a while, you do have some of those issues. And again, we apologize for that. Coming up in this hour, we will be joined by a 7th District Congressional candidate, Elsa Duranceau. She is running for the Democratic nomination for the seat in the Congress, as two Democrats are running against Tom Tiffany. Yep, Tom Tiffany running for yet another term in office. But we got two very quality candidates on the Democratic side. And we've been speaking to both of them in this campaign. Starting to heat up as we get into the summer. Then we'll have the countdown towards the primary, and then, of course, the general election as well coming up in November. So we'll talk to Elsa about what she's found on the campaign trail at this point, and be able to find out more about Elsa Duranceau coming up in a few minutes at 9:34 this morning on the program. Also, I would like to remind you that hopefully the rain will go away, and that later this afternoon we will have high school softball as the Wausau West Warriors taking on Mosinee. Mosinee, number one ranked team in the state in Division II. Wausau West coming off a 10-3 win over Merrill yesterday. Final game of the regular season for the Warriors. Coverage begins with the pregame show at 4:20 and the first pitch at 4:30. That's Wausau West High School softball coming up later this afternoon here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Online at bowfallsradio.com, mobile devices, and Alexa by searching WXCO and on the Civic Media app. Well, we haven't had a chance to properly introduce our in-studio engineer yet, Ian Welsh. Ian, good morning.
Morning, Jed. It was a busy first hour, I know.
It was a busy first hour. Again, thanks to our guest every Thursday morning. Every Thursday, it always it does seem like we have should have a ticket booth for all the guests that we have coming in. Always joined by Pat Kreitlow to start things off. And then, of course, we have North Star Nose at the bottom of the hour. And coming up again in this hour, Elsa Duranceau. It is now the 16th of May. You're just over 2 weeks away from the opening of Anything Goes, the Cole Porter legendary musical, the Wausau Community Theater. It'll be May 31st, June 1st, June 2nd, and then another big weekend. In fact, you have, what, three shows the first weekend, and what, you have five shows the second week?
That's right.
I mean, that's pretty amazing.
Eight shows all together. We have two shows on the second Saturday.
Yep.
So that will be a long a day, so drink plenty of water, tea, cough drops, everything.
Yeah, I see. You got Friday, Saturday, and Sunday the first week, May 31st, June 1st, and June 2nd. Then you start on Thursday the second week on June the 6th. Then a Friday night show, as you said, matinee on Saturday, plus a night show on Saturday, and then on Sunday afternoon as well. So, again, lots of opportunities to see Anything Goes. And I know that the process has been continuing. How did the rehearsal last night go?
Last night was a pretty good rehearsal. It was just a music review, so just trying to tighten up all the vocals of the big group numbers and the duets and the solos as well. It was a longer rehearsal, but I thought it went very well, and I think we have a better handle on our songs moving forward. Because tonight is a big night. It's the actual first official night off book. So it's a pretty big a deal. And if you don't know your lines, you just say line and they'll help you out. But don't say anything else. You just have to say line and that's it, because we need to get the timing of the show down as well.
Well, big, hopefully it'll go well tonight, but I wanted to talk a little bit about what is possible when people let their voice be heard. And, of course, one of the big stories here in Wausau has been the change of the name of the Monk Botanical Gardens to Wausau Botanical Gardens. Well, the board of directors has said, all right, we've heard you. We've heard your voices. We made a mistake. And the board has decided to change the name back.
Yeah, I heard about this on Channel 7.
Yep.
Last night. I was very happy with that.
Exactly. Yeah. Again, it's number one. Finally, they're talking to the family. I mean, we kept hearing, we haven't talked to the family. Well, Robert W. Monk IV had a lengthy conversation with the board president, Paul David, and he says, I think it's the correct thing to do. So, again, because in the end, having people pulling apart from each other wasn't going to help anybody. It wasn't going to help the gardens. No. It wasn't going to help the folks that enjoy the gardens, who may feel like, I can't go to it anymore because of what they did. So everybody is, I think, going to be much happier. And again, the idea, the board apparently felt, when they made the name change, that having the monk name in the title was confusing people. I mean, come on.
Confusing how exactly?
I don't know, but
maybe you can tell us how it's confusing. We'll gladly listen, but if you don't have a reason for it, that is just kind of silly.
They said that the monk name in the title was confusing people, and the gardens needed a new name that highlighted the work of many Wausau volunteers who helped build the gardens to what they are today. But the outcry from the Monk family and the public after the announcement did change their mind. The board said in a news release issued yesterday afternoon, as the board of the Robert W. Monk Gardens Incorporated organization continues the process of refreshing the garden's name and logo, we want to ensure that the legacy of Mr. Monk and the garden's future are both clearly reflected. The release states that the board recognizes it made a mistake in originally removing the name of the garden's founder and regrets the confusion and disappointment it caused by the oversight. The board will return to using the Monk Botanical Gardens as the name and logo, the release says. They also said that this measure reflects our commitment to honoring Robert W. Monk III's legacy while we work diligently to incorporate Robert W. Monk more thoughtfully into the name and identity of the organization. I hope as they continue this discussion, however, because it sounds as though they're still going to be working on some sort of change.
What change exactly?
I don't know, because it sounds like, again, Monk IV said that he gave David a few other suggestions for the gardens when they talked Wednesday afternoon.
That's good.
The suggestions included the restoration of the memorial site for Monk III and his wife Carol. A bridge that crossed a man-made pond led to the place where the couple's ashes are buried. The bridge has needed replacing for years, according to both the garden's executive director, Darcy Howard, and members of the Monk family. Monk IV said if they address that and do some other positive things rather than talk about it, I'm certainly willing to work with them. So the gardens board needs to refocus on what it has to do moving forward, Monk IV said. He said he hopes there hasn't been so much damage in the past few weeks that it can't be fixed. So, again, and another member of the family, Katie Monk, Monk III's granddaughter, said she's cautiously optimistic about the news the name of the gardens will be changed back. She says it's definitely step one, and that is the biggest step. We've got more work to do with the leadership and the next phase of the garden. Like her uncle, Katie Monk would like to see the board of directors restore Monk III and his wife's gravesite. And Katie Monk said, I think that would show it's more than just words. She also said she's grateful for the number of people in the Wausau community who stood up and made their voices heard on the issue changing the garden's name. Katie Monk said, "I am touched. My grandfather meant so much to the community. Even if folks hadn't met him or interacted with him, his contributions are valued."
Absolutely.
So Katie Monk said the family had met with the board and asked the members not to change the name, but got dismissed. She doesn't think the board would have changed its mind if the community had not stepped up. And I think that is very true. The board has asked for the public's understanding and patience as they continue to navigate through the process and bring to light visions that inspire all. Katie Monk said as well, I think a statement that is kind of, I think a very true one is, the train's back on the track. And we have to make sure it keeps going in the right direction.
Indeed.
So, again, I called this before an unforced error. And I think that is so true. It was an unforced error by the board of the Monk Botanical Gardens. It did not have to be made. I don't understand where this confusion comes from. Again, it's like saying people are confused about Camp Randall Stadium. Where's Camp Randall Stadium? I don't know where Camp Randall Stadium. No, people know where Camp Randall Stadium is. Mm-hmm. It's a name in the title. They know what it's about. And people that care about the gardens knew that the Monk Botanical Gardens was in Wausau. And the idea that somehow they need to put Wausau in there for some reason is silly. They could put Wausau in there somewhere. It could be Monk Botanical Gardens of Wausau. I mean, come on. So again, the good news
just
is
put it on the end of the name. Just put it on the end of the name.
Yes,
you don't have to change the name. Entirely.
Or remove it. So you're exactly right. So, again, that is one of the aspects. As I talk about it, I shake my head. It's just one of those things, again, an unforced error, you know, trying to fix the unforced error. We'll see where it goes from here. I mean,
I'm
again.
I'm really glad the people stood up and they got on the horn and they got the petition and they got the community support.
Yep, exactly right.
It really made a difference.
It certainly did. The time is 9:18. We're going to come back, have our sports update, and then also coming up in just a little bit, Elsa Duranceau, the Democratic candidate for the 7th Congressional District, trying to unseat Tom Tiffany. We'll talk to her coming up at 9:34. With Ian Welsh, I'm Chad Holmes. Chad Holmes Show, Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Chad Holmes Show on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, bowfallsradio.com, mobile devices, and Alexa by searching WXCO, and on the Civic Media app. Again, 50 degrees is the temperature. The rain, I think, has stopped. It's now cloudy skies. We're expecting, again, a chance of more rain as we get later into the day. We'll talk more about that coming up. But time to talk a little sports. And yesterday, Packer fans at the calendar circle, they were waiting to see what the schedule would be for the green and gold as we get to the 2024 season. And yesterday, the NFL officially announced the schedule. And it's an interesting schedule for the Green Bay Packers. We had known already because they had announced that the first game of the season would be on Friday, September the 6th, against the Philadelphia Eagles down in Sao Paulo, Brazil, a game that would be aired on the Peacock Network online. And now the rest of the schedule has come out, and one of the interesting aspects of this schedule is the Packers, late in the season, have four consecutive night games. You don't see that very often. We're used to seeing Sunday afternoon football, but when you start off on Thanksgiving night, the Packers will have the primetime game on NBC against the Miami Dolphins at Lambeau Field. Then the next week, the Packers will travel to Detroit for another Thursday night game. This one will be on Amazon Prime Video. So there's two games that are going to be streamed on the streaming services, not over the air. So here, I think in the Wausau area, we will not have a TV station that has the games on the air. You have to either have Prime Video for the Detroit game or Peacock for the season opener. Then
people aren't going to be happy about that.
Yep, and then the following week on Sunday, December the 15th, the Packers, another Sunday night game, will be taking on Seattle on the road on NBC. And then the following week, they'll be on Monday Night Football hosting the New Orleans Saints on Monday, December the 23rd in the game at Lambeau Field. Back when I was growing up, the Packers did not have late season night games at home. Back then, the NFL basically tried to avoid having cold weather sites hosting night games. That has gone out the window in recent years. They don't care now. They think it's cool to be frigid and have these late night games in Green Bay. And it's all about the TV dollars. And so, again, I don't like all those night games. Having four night games in a row week 10 to 13, I mean, gee whiz. I mean, Thursday night game, Sunday night game, Monday night game. I mean, just craziness.
It's pretty scattered, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, it is.
One of the games I saw as I was watching the news this morning that was pretty interesting is that on Thanksgiving of this year, the Packers will be playing the Dolphins.
Yep.
But that should be an interesting game, because I know that last year's Packer game against the Lions was
it was a big win for Green Bay. Really did spark the Packers.
I was gonna say it was unexpected is what it was.
Yep, that was the big turnaround game. In fact, they were basically dead and buried in terms of the playoffs, and they won that one and started a great streak that finished off the season, ultimately got them to the playoffs. So yeah, you're exactly right, that was a big one. This one will be the last game of the day, so a 7:20 kickoff in Green Bay against Miami. So the Lions will take on the Bears in the first game, and then Dallas has their annual Thanksgiving Day game as well. And then the Packers will get the third one at home against Miami. So, again,
I wonder how many people are going to actually turn up for the Brazil Packer game. You know, are people going to actually go to Brazil and watch the game?
Oh, there's going to be a few, more than a few. I think there's going to be more than a few. Yeah, so.
I mean, I'll probably just get the update on my phone, probably.
Yeah. Well, I got Peacock, fortunately, so I guess but the thing is, I will not be watching that game because I do not watch college games, and I will not watch an NFL game that airs on a Friday night during high school football season. That's my boycott.
I understand.
Yep, because I'll be doing a game that night, so so I will be competing against the Green Bay Packers on that night, so. So, boo to the NFL having a Friday night game.
Mm-hmm.
Brewers yesterday, they used 5 home runs. They went deep 5 different times to beat the Pittsburgh Pirates.
Yay.
10-2. They went 2 out of 3 in that series. William Contreras had 4 RBIs and 3 hits. Jackson Churio got a 2-run homer. He is off to a decent start this season. He had hit that one 441 feet. So, the Brewers now hold a 2-game lead over the Chicago Cubs in the NL Central. They will be off today before heading off to Houston to start off a 9-game road trip. They'll start off this weekend taking on Houston on the road. They will also be having games with the Marlins on this road trip, and then they'll finish off in Boston. So really a good start for the Brewers. 2-game lead over the Cubs. Exactly right. High school sports yesterday in a game that we had here on Bow Falls Radio. In high school softball, Wausau West defeated Merrill by a score of 10-3. The Warriors back in action this afternoon, playing host to the Mosinee Indians. Again, Mosinee, number 1 in the state in Division 2. Wausau West and Mosinee, 4:20 for the pregame, 4:30 for the first pitch, right here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, online at bowfallsradio.com, mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO, and on the Civic Media app. Also last night, the brackets were released for the Division 1 high school softball playoffs. And Wausau West is a number 9 seed in their Division 1 sectional. So that means that the Warriors, next Tuesday in their first playoff game, a regional semifinal, they will have to travel quite a bit, actually, to a Menominee, to take on Menominee in that first game. Number 9 seed Wausau West at number 8 seed Menominee. And I will be heading to Menominee as well next Tuesday for live coverage of that one here on Bull Falls Radio 98.9 and 1230. Other area teams in that Division One bracket, Stevens Point, the Wisconsin Valley Conference champions, are number 1 seed. They get a first-round bye. They will take on the winner of the Wausau West Menominee game in a regional final coming up a week from today on Thursday, May 23rd. Also in that bracket, Wausau East is a number 12 seed. The Lumberjacks will be at Wisconsin Rapids, the number 5 seed, in a regional semifinal next week. DC Everest is the number 3 seed. The Evergreens will play host to number 14 seeded Eau Claire Memorial in a regional game next Tuesday. Marshfield from the WVC is seeded number 11, and they will be at number 6 Hudson. So that's an exciting time as the girls softball tournament gets underway. And again, Wausau West at Menominee next Tuesday, live right here on Bull Falls Radio 98.9 and 1230. We're still waiting now. After this, we'll get the baseball brackets coming out within the next week. Again, overcast skies here in downtown Wausau, temperature of 50 degrees, chance of showers, maybe a few thunderstorms as well, mainly before 3 p.m. today, and the high expected to reach 65 degrees. Well, we have an information update coming up. We're going to find out what's happening in news, weather, and sports, national news, state news with Terry Bell, local news, and weather with Brittany Merlot, and again, Mike Clemens will have the sports report as well. But coming up next, we will be talking to one of the candidates for the 7th Congressional District. Yep, Tom Tiffany going up for re-election. But a couple of Democrats would like to say to Tom Tiffany, your services are no longer needed. And we'll be talking to Elsa Duranceau, one of the candidates for the 7th, coming up next. With Ian Welsh, I'm Chad Holmes. It is the Chad Holmes Show, Bull Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. And welcome back. Chad Holmes with you here on Bull Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, online at bullfallsradio.com, mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO, and on the Civic Media app. And again, you can also join us by going to our Facebook page or our X page, Bull Falls Radio. We do have a live stream there as well. And 2024, obviously a very busy year with the elections coming up and in the 7th Congressional District, which involves here in Marathon County and a lot of places up north as well. It's a big piece of land in the state of Wisconsin. Tom Tiffany is the current incumbent in the 7th Congressional District. He is running for re-election on the Republican side, and a couple of Democrats are running to replace Tom Tiffany. We're very happy to welcome one of the Democratic candidates, Elsa Duranceau, who is, again, a Democrat for the 7th Congressional District. And also, thank you for coming, number one, coming on the show and coming straight here into our studio as well.
Well, thank you for having me.
Before we talk about some of the issues, again, for folks that may not be familiar with you, could you give us a little thumbnail sketch of your background, maybe where you've come from in terms of where you were raised, where you live, and maybe what you've done leading up to this race for Congress?
Yeah, absolutely. So I was born and raised in Merrill, Wisconsin. I'm a graduate from the year 2000 there, and then I went on to join the Air Force. I spent 8 years in the Air Force and then graduated from UW-Madison. I got into nonprofit work. I spent a bunch of time at the Henry Vilas Zoological Society, and I just learned the ins and outs of nonprofit, and that's where I got into public policy and the public-private partnerships and how important that is and how intricate those relationships are and in shaping our communities. So during the pandemic, I had the opportunity to work with the North Central Wisconsin Workforce Development Board. They're out of Stevens Point, but they cover 9 counties, and I really got into Wisconsin workforce grants and I worked with the WAI grant, which is the Worker Advancement Initiative, and got into the childcare industry with that. So the WAI was a ARPA funding project and allowed me to really research the issues, like what are the core issues of coming off of the pandemic, what industries were most affected by the pandemic, and then create solutions with this. It was almost $1 million. And, you know, how do we support workers to successfully re-enter into the workforce? So from there, and really having an intimate, insight into the childcare industry and all of the issues that are, you know, surrounding that, I realized that there's a lot of opportunity, especially at the federal level, for assistance to that. Mm-hmm. And when it finally came as an option, our current representative voted to not support the childcare industry, and I really thought that was pretty crappy. So I decided then and there that it was time for me to get into the race.
Jumping into a congressional race, that's a big pond. And as I said, this is a big district. What have you learned so far since you've started running? I mean, in terms of maybe even talking to folks, in terms of just things that maybe were unexpected when you jumped into the race.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's an excellent question. So when I first jumped in, I realized that there's a lack of communication. There's a huge divide, and I had listened to a show of yours recently where you were talking about, you know, whether there's an R in front of your name or a D in front of your name, like that is an immediate barrier to conversations. We're all experiencing the same issues. So we all have to, in whether or not it's uncomfortable, get into the same rooms and figure this out. And what I've learned is that everybody cares on both sides. Everybody cares about this. It's just how are we going to approach it? What are the options of approaching these issues? And then choosing which ones are the best. And that's ultimately what the issues are. So childcare, I'm going to use as an example. At the state level, you have one side who wants to subsidize the industry with our tax dollars. Mm-hmm. And then you have the other side who says, no, we're not going into the subsidizing. We can change policies that will help support the growth of the industry. And quite frankly, both of those approaches do not actually address the actual issue, which is the cost of care. Mm-hmm. And when you hit the threshold of how much you can sell that service for, and then the families can't afford it, then it's a breakdown of the entire industry. And in my work, I realized that the childcare industry needs an additional revenue stream, and it may not be just subsidizing from the state or the federal government, but it has to be something else. And what that thing is, that's up for exploration.
That's one of the, I think, really important issues. I think along the same lines, when you talk generally about healthcare, and I think maybe housing, some of these issues are issues that I think can be discussed and some answers can be found at the local level, at the state level, at the federal level. When you look at the job of the congressperson, what do you think you could do with in those areas? I think those are areas that I see as really important issues in terms of quality of life in the 7th Congressional District. How much can you, at the federal level as compared to maybe the state level and the local level, how do you see that mix in some of these issues? And I think they get really close to the core of the people that live here.
Oh, absolutely. So at the federal level, so we have these, you know, HUD, for example, and our Section 8 housing vouchers and stuff. And then even so our Rural Development USDA, they are the administrators of the grant programs that are designed to help solve these issues that we're talking about here. And there's a lot of red tape to them. And sometimes the details or the thresholds that an area has to qualify for. So, for example, I'm just going to use this, and this is something that I learned up in Lincoln County, is that even though Lincoln County and all of the townships are very, very rural, and there are programs out there to help with, like, building new anchor facilities, like a town hall. And you can have a very, very rural, very, very poor area. But if there are like two millionaires or two multimillionaires that live within that township, then they all of a sudden do not qualify for these programs that exist because they've gone outside of the threshold of what the median household income is. That is a pretty huge deal. You know, you've got 98% of the people who would, you know, qualify for that, but then these two or three that supersede however much the income level is now disqualifies the entire township from participating in these kinds of programs. So looking at those types of details at the federal level is really what would make change coming down the pipeline, and that's what I would do.
You look at priorities, and again, I think that if you go back in history, you go back to the 60s and the Great Society and the fight against poverty, and I've had discussions with people who talk about, well, we don't even talk about that anymore. I mean, is that an area as well? Because I think in this community we have talks about the homeless population. And sometimes I think the whole issue of poverty goes below the surface. Do you have any thoughts on maybe a role that I don't think it, with the makeup right now of what Washington looks like, that you're going to be able to have a great society again? But is there a role that you can see within as a congressperson in that realm, especially with poverty? I don't think we talk about that enough.
No, poverty, I mean, so all of these issues, including poverty, are all connected. You know, the housing issue is directly connected to the childcare industry, and then the lack of childcare industry or lack of childcare increases actually the poverty levels, because families, say if you are in an intact family and one of the, and it's generally the mother, stays home, they're losing one whole income into the household, and that drops them down into a lower, income level. The key issues here are that we have to get into a public-private partnerships, and that includes the government and your nonprofit sectors, and then employers. So back in the 60s and even 70s and even far before that, employers and industry had a huge role in housing and creating housing and workforce housing. So railroads and even your like mill industries, they were the ones who built the houses and then brought their workers in.
Yeah.
So we need to explore what was in the past as a solution into the future.
Again, we're talking to 7th District Democratic candidate Elsa Duranceau here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. In terms of priorities, I think we've touched on a few of those. What other areas would you say that within a first term that you would also be focused on? Because I do think that so often you can talk about a lot of different areas, but getting to the core, the priorities, if you had the fortunate aspect of winning both the primary and the general election and starting in January of 2025, you said, I think we talked about a few of those. What are some other areas of priorities that the people of the 7th would be able to look at and say, hey, she's working on this?
So I'm super passionate about our rights to privacy, and that includes our private, ownership of our bodies. And that was, the Roe versus Wade case really argued that you and I have the inherent right to privacy that is implied in the 14th Amendment, and that decision was overturned with the overturning of Roe v. Wade. And that opened the door to a lot of what we're seeing right now with what I would say is an abhorrent action on my rights as a human being. Just like reproductive rights, I need to specify, a woman's right to an abortion, but also our right to our health privacy. That is a federal right, I believe, in our privacy. And with the advancement of AI, we are ultimately left. Anything that we do online is there are no protections. We have no protections. So my priorities are going in there and being a part of those conversations and keeping the individual instead of the organization or the corporations like Google, Meta, that we need to be protecting us, not them. And how are we going to do that? But those conversations have been started. The Biden administration does have an AI Bill of Rights, but that's kind of just a mere suggestion to these organizations on how they should be ethically approaching our privacy and our data. But it needs to be implemented into law with people, with us at the forefront.
And I think that kind of connects with generational change as well, because I've seen stories where some of the older members of either the United States Senate or the House have been asked about AI, and they basically admit, I have no idea. Mm-hmm. I have no idea. I have. There are, I think, issues out there when it involves technology that there's a real gap between what the knowledge is of the people that are supposedly making these decisions and those that are trying to maybe craft the legislation to their own advantage. Mm-hmm. I imagine that somebody that has grown up in this technological wave, you know, you have to work in it, both in terms of your military career and your out of military career. I imagine that's a positive that, hey, I understand some of these changes and can be more effective than maybe mm-hmm. some of the older folks.
Yes, absolutely. I would even argue that the people who are implementing these AI programs don't even know what they're doing or have control over what it is that they're developing. And if they're unleashing it and they don't even have control on it, how are we expected to control or protect ourselves? But yeah, absolutely. I have worked with some pretty insane systems. I have to be very careful when I speak there. You know, but yes, I do have a very intimate understanding of the capabilities of AI, particularly in warfare.
We got to take a quick break. We're going to come back with a few more minutes with the 7th Congressional candidate, Elsa Duranceau. I want to talk a little bit maybe about areas that are more worldwide field, because obviously there's a lot of issues around the globe right now, and including, you know, Tom Tiffany loves to talk about the border. And I think mm-hmm. we got to talk a little bit about that and also some international, because that's part of the job as a congressperson as well. So we're going to come back and talk for a few more minutes with Elsa Duranceau, 7th District Democratic candidate. The time is almost 9:49. Chad Holmes Show, Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. And welcome back. Chad Holmes with you here on Bow Falls Radio. Elsa Duranceau, candidate for the 7th Congressional District, running in the Democratic primary. Before we talk about some of those bigger, I think, global issues, how do you plan out campaigning? Because, as I said, this is a lot of area to cover. And again, we were just talking about, again, name recognition being important. When you're not an incumbent, always has that natural name recognition, or somebody that's run and won other offices. And I think you're trying to, you know, basically start from the bottom and work your way up to have name recognition so people know who you are and then start listening to what you have to say in terms of some of these issues. Do you have a plan on how you campaign? Where do you go? Where do you travel? Mm-hmm. Could you maybe give a little insight into how you're trying to build maybe that name recognition and get your voice out there to the people that you have to reach in terms of both the primary election and then potentially a general election?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've been working on that for a really long time. So I have tested out all kinds of different avenues. Last summer, I really jumped into and did the traditional candidate thing. I went to Democratic picnics. I, you know, met all of the leaders of the Democratic Party throughout the District 7. I did parades. Mm-hmm. I, you know, shook hands, went to fairs. I did all that stuff. And that was, you know, that was really great. It was a wonderful experience. It was hard. I've never done anything like that before. But then I really realized that the best way to do it is to do my work. I, you know, work in nonprofit and I'm a grant writer, and I really got into the childcare industry. So I launched a nonprofit that will address the childcare issues at the core that I had discussed earlier. And really reaching out and like helping communities to find not just, you know, to identify the issues, but to find solutions. And I had an opportunity to do my work in Lincoln County. So when I am campaigning now, I have a base. I went back home. I went back to Merrill and I did my work there. With that work is where that recognition is coming from. So as I'm doing my signature gathering, I've been really sticking home. I'm doing work with the childcare industry in St. Croix area. So I will be going there and just, you know, making those reconnections with the people that are there. As the campaign goes on, I will just be hitting the road. I will be, you know, spending as much time as I can in the, you know, 24 plus counties that District 7 has. But yeah, it's really about traveling and making the connections, making the effort. Like, I can't just sit home and rely on Facebook.
No, that's very, very true. Let's talk about some of the global issues. And okay. I think involving, you know, what Tom Tiffany calls, you know, in terms of border security. And also, obviously, we're seeing these hot spots around the world. I mean, there's so much, you know, energy and controversy and passion when it comes to Israel and Hamas. And, of course, you still have the Ukraine and Russia. Maybe, you know, I'm going to kind of open it up for you to talk a little bit about your thoughts on global issues, on foreign policy and that part of the job. But obviously, you know, as, a new candidate, you don't have that background in the same way that maybe an incumbent has. What are your thoughts, maybe general thoughts on foreign issues and border issues?
Mm-hmm. I'll start with the border issue. Yeah. So media has a lot to play in these issues. It's a hot button topic because it's being driven down our throats. Mm-hmm. I like to ask people, how has the border crisis affected you personally? And generally, people cannot tell me why. Or they're like, well, in 10 years, this will be an issue for us up here in District 7. I'm like, okay, well, in 10 years? I'm not saying that there's not an issue. There absolutely is an issue with processing these people who are attempting to come here legally, you know, as refugees from whatever disaster areas that they're coming from. Do the processes need to be readjusted? Absolutely. And I would be happy to be a part of that, you know, coming up with the solutions to and how we process people seeking refuge here in the United States. Do I believe that there are millions of people who are pounding at or crossing over the Rio Grande into the... No, I don't. And I would go down there just to look, just to be like, hey, guys, look, there's not millions of people crossing our borders. I think that this is generated outrage, and we need to turn our TVs off. If you are outraged here in District 7 about the border issue, we need to turn our TVs off, change the channel, go outside, go to the park and meet some people, go down to the homeless center and see how you can help. I can't turn people's emotions off on that, but hopefully I, you know, with some clever messaging, I can maybe get people to redirect on what our issues really are here in this area.
Unfortunately, that's what Congress and Tiffany talks about. I mean, 2 years ago at an event here in Wausau, his face turns dark and he talks about the border and he brings it up all the time. So I think that's very important that people, you know, like yourself and other candidates, you know, push back on the idea where, frankly, the facts don't square with the tone that a congressman like Tom Tiffany has had.
Mm-hmm. And they had a solution. They were about to pass something and then they didn't. Okay, you care about the border so much, then go pass that resolution.
What about foreign policy? I mean, in terms of, you know, you said you have a military background. Is that something that can help you in terms of being, you know, involved in that aspect of the job as well?
Yes. Yes, absolutely. I mean, when we talk about Ukraine and even what's going on in Israel, I mean, it is so much bigger than any of us can ever really truly comprehend about what's happening. You know, there's the economic, and I'm going to speak to Ukraine now about, like, why is Russia doing that? Why would Russia go into the Ukraine? Well, Ukraine is sitting on a massive amount of natural resources, you know, and by taking over that area, Russia then positions themselves to be even more powerful in that sense. So it's like when you start to understand, like, why is this happening in Ukraine specifically, and it comes down to the economics and, you know, natural resources. When we're talking about Israel, this is so wild, you know, like, and this is my opinion here on this, is that we fought World War II and against Nazi Germany because they were essentially exterminating a group of people. And now that group of people, or not that group of people, but Israel is doing the same to another group of people, yet we are supporting it monetarily. And how is that different? How is this different, and why are we choosing this other side in this situation? I am totally against it.
Where can people get more information?
I am actually changing my website. So it should be launched later on today. It is elsaforwisconsin.org.
Very good. Elsa Duranceau. Hopefully have you back sometime soon in the run-up to the primary.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for everyone for joining us. We'll be back tomorrow morning from 8 till 10 a.m. Chad Holmes Show, Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230.